guys, welcome to the Garbage Time Podcast. I'm your host, Katie Nolan. It is NFL Draft Week, so my guest on today's podcast is Fox NFL reporter and my best friend ever, Peter Schrager. We talked about Jared Goff and Carson Wentz. I'm Team Wentz. We'll see what you guys think. We talked about how Twitter has affected the draft and other NFL news, like Josh Norman and Colin Kaepernick, Tom Brady a little bit. We also talked about Prince and Beyonce, because this is a sports podcast. Take a listen. Peter Schrager! Hi, Peter.
Hey, how are you doing?
Good, how are you?
I'm great.
Have I seen you since the Super Bowl?
No. And I wanted to congratulate you on the Emmy nomination.
Oh, thank you. Yes, that's why I brought it up.
And also being in the scoreboard at Fenway, which I think is a pretty big deal.
It was so cool.
Yeah.
And people made fun of me for thinking it was really cool, but like, fuck those people, it was really cool.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it was pretty great. Yeah. Life's going okay.
Where were you when you found out the Emmy nomination? Because I saw it and it was like, Football Night in America, mm-hmm. Okay, Fox NFL Sunday, and I see Garbage Time with Katie Nolan. Not that it wasn't deserved, but also I was like, that's the real deal. This isn't like some strange like web.com thing. This is like the real deal.
Yeah.
Where were you?
Well, so I was walking in. Ashley and I were actually going to get coffee.
Where do you go for coffee around here?
Well, we went to Starbucks.
Oh,
but there's also a La Colombe across the street that sometimes we'll go to. There's also a Dunkin' Donuts. Depends on my mood.
Yeah, that's
there's also a coffee guy on a cart right outside our office who accosts us and forces
us. Hot coffee and a roll.
Producer Matt has like a tab running with that guy. Up to about $100 now,
that's
I think.
It.
He'll never pay it. But so I was walking in with Ashley and I ran into producer Matt and he said, there's news. And so I went into the conference room and everyone was sitting there and I was like, what's the news? And they were like, we got nominated for 2 Emmys. And it was like, what?
Does it sink in that it's like the real, because there's all these other awards, right?
Yeah.
Does it sink in right away? Like, oh wait, the Emmys.
Yeah. Well, so like I tweeted that we were nominated for an Emmy or something and someone like Matt Ufford or something said, asterisk sports Emmy. Which is like, oh, wait, are they not the same?
No, it's all the same
thing. But they're
the same. It's all the same organization.
We just have a separate night.
Yeah, you got your daytime Emmys with Susan Lucci, and then you got your sports Emmys with Katie Nolan.
Yeah, that's right. So we're going to not win them, but that's okay.
That's
we got nominated, and a nomination is a win.
It's amazing.
I think I might be presenting, I found out.
Really?
So that's cool.
So I've been, I've been to the sports Emmys.
Oh, you have?
I used to work for Inside the NFL, the show.
Whoa,
and we were up for the same
show.
Same award, the weekly show. Are they up against you guys?
I think, no, Inside the NBA.
I don't think I got nominated, but we won. It was the same one, weekly studio show. And it was a who's who. It's like the people you grew up watching. So I was like in the room with like Al Michaels like next to me. And I was like, it's pretty cool, you know?
Yeah.
And then to be on that stage, Katie, you got to deliver. You got to be funny. You can't be like fake funny. You got to be
funny. Well, I'm never funny. So that's
you better write your own material.
Really
don't leave it to the sports Emmys, people.
Okay. I Googled it, like Google Image, to see if I'm supposed to wear a gown. Nobody wore a gown last year.
I don't know that answer.
So now I don't know what to wear. I've got a whole list on Rent the Runway of things I'm like harding of like
what's
I could
Rent the Runway?
So it's this app on your phone when you don't have the means to purchase a gown because I'm never going to wear a gown again.
So it's like Airbnb of dresses.
Basically. You rent it for 3 days and then you send it back.
Perfect.
And somebody else wears
Perfect.
It. So that's what I'm doing, but I don't know what lane
have you used
to
it before?
Go down. Yeah, I used it for weddings.
And
it's good for weddings. Oh, it's great. They send you 2 sizes. This podcast is brought to you by Rent the Runway. They send you 2 sizes so you can like, oh no, that one didn't fit, but don't worry, I've got this other one.
And then afterwards, Monday, you just ship it back.
Send it right back.
Oh my God.
And they prepay the shipping and everything.
You know what they're doing? They're disrupting the market.
They sure are.
Disrupting.
Hashtag disrupt.
They're disrupting the market.
This is what people tuned in to listen to.
Yeah.
Rent the Runway.
Yeah.
Big week for you.
Yeah, huge.
Right?
Huge.
Like, so what have you been doing since Super Bowl to now? And then the draft starts Thursday.
Yep.
So this is like you're getting back into like your season,
right?
Oh, no.
This is the end of the season for me. So straight from Super Bowl. I haven't had a vacation or anything. You just keep going because the combine is as big as the Super Bowl is for like this kind of stuff. And it's more, I don't even know how to explain. It's like, the stuff on the field is important, but it's more like every coach, every GM, every front office guy is all in Indianapolis for 4 days.
Yeah.
And no one's even worried about the college kids yet. Like your scout is watching. We'll get all that. It's all just drinking, hanging out, getting information, seeing how free agency is going to play out. So free agency is in March. Then you've got, obviously, these pro days where they try out. And then you've got the owners' meetings, which is also in March. So you're getting like, but there's so much stuff going on and there's so much information to be had that by the time we get to the draft, it's like an entirely other football season that's already occurred since the Super Bowl. So it's been 3 months. The draft is like the greatest like jubilation of these kids' lives. It's awesome that first night. And then Friday, Saturday is the second day. third day, and then it's over, and then it's kind of like chill for the next couple months.
So then you take a vacay.
Yeah.
Where are you going?
Laguna Beach.
Wait, really?
Never been.
Steven!
I want to see Steven. I want to see Heidi. Do they still hang, you think?
I don't know. What's Steven Coletti?
Oh, yeah, you don't know.
Steven Coletti. What's he doing now?
I wouldn't know. I don't know.
I fucking love Laguna Beach.
I think I just missed like Laguna Beach. I'm a little older than you. Like, I was already like professionally working and all this stuff. And I knew it was a sensation. But I didn't get into the Lauren, the hills. I didn't really get into the hills. So just the first
couple
seasons.
Luckily for you, I have seasons 1 and 2 of Laguna Beach on DVD. And
which I had a DVD player. We're going
to
get it. It'll be great.
Whenever you'd like.
It'll be great. But they always had the funniest names, right? Like the men were like Dieter and Tristan.
Wow. No, he didn't watch for sure. Dieter. Dieter was a name.
It's a great name.
It's an awful name.
You don't have that name if you don't live in Laguna Beach.
Dieter. So you're going to Laguna Beach for how long?
I'll go for a week.
Okay.
Yeah, vacation with my wife. We'll have a good time. But that's like chill, which is what I want, because these last couple of days have been crazy. And then every year at the draft, so Monday is kind of like this buildup. Then I'll fly in tomorrow to Chicago, which we're recording this on Monday. Tuesday I'll be in Chicago. And then at the draft, something wild will happen. Last year,
like,
was
a streaker runs across the stage.
Yeah, sort of. But it's like this guy, Lyle Collins, was like accused of murder. He was a first-round prospect.
Crazy,
right?
Just like a streaker.
So like, just like a streaker, similar. It's zany. So then you got to kind of react off that and get the news on that. This week, this Tom Brady thing happens on Monday. We don't have to go into it.
This shit.
We don't have to go into it because I think America is fatigued from it.
So fatigued.
And it's different than last year. My point was with last year, they were defending the Super Bowl. So there's all this intrigue of like, we've got our quarterback and it's defending the Super Bowl and what are we going to do week one without? They didn't win the Super Bowl this year. If he misses 4 games, we're all just so tired of talking about it that like, I think even Patriots fans are like, all right, fine, let's just be done with it if that's what it takes.
Yes.
So that's kind of came out today and it's kind of blown over.
I don't give a fuck.
I don't think anyone does.
I don't fucking care anymore.
Katie, I don't think anyone does.
I'm so tired.
Like, I put it on ESPN and Stephen A. Smith was like doing a whole thing and I changed it because I was like, I can't. I just can't like digest this anymore.
Yeah, or just also because it was Stephen A. Smith.
Sure, whatever you want. But like,
well, we were talking about how it was so funny that when we came back for season 2 of our show, it was when Deflategate was happening. We were all back in football and then we're about to come back. Our show comes back May 4th and we're sitting today like, what are we going to do for our first episode?
And here we are again.
And Deflategate comes back up and it's like, oh my God.
It'll be interesting to check because, you know, the metrics on articles you write. And last year, a lot of my stuff on Deflategate did really well, like on the web. Like, you put it up, people click, they're fascinated, they tweet. I would argue that if I did something today just on my thoughts on the latest, it would get like zero traction. People don't want to hear about it anymore.
I think we've digested
I think
all
it's done.
That we
and
can.
If he misses 4 games, at this point, fine, let's just move
but
on.
But so what if he requests the stay and then like
I can't get into it, right? It's like you just get sick of it.
It's like, I don't know, just take your 4 games.
But that's just an example of how this week, like, that'll come out. Then Sam Bradford comes out, he's not going to show up to camp. That'll come out.
Oh and no,
then
what will we do without Sam Bradford?
And then the draft itself, like, weird stuff's going to happen. So the next.
That's like when your creepy uncle's like, I'm not coming to Thanksgiving.
That's it.
You're like, oh darn.
I'm going to sit it out.
Please come.
Yeah, we want you there. I know, and Bradford, like, he's never been tested before. He's always been, like, the guy, wherever he's been, whether it's the Rams or the Eagles. So, finally, here's Chase Daniel, and you're going to have this rookie quarterback, and it's a competition, and the first reaction is to crumble and sit in the corner and say, I don't
know.
Yeah, you just got $22 million guaranteed. Show up and do your job.
Yeah, dude. Yeah.
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 I liked that.
Yeah.
Fucking go to work.
Come on.
I don't not go to work.
No.
Well, last week I didn't come,
well,
but I needed
fun.
A vacation, Peter. It'd been a really long time.
That's good.
What do you do during the draft? Are you always on your phone? Are you texting teams and agents? Are you like,
I remember
to
last
people?
Year you texted me day 2. You were like, what's up with this Randy Gregory?
I did. I
and
really
we were texting,
and
I was like, the Cowboys will take him. And
yeah.
I felt really smart afterwards. I remember thinking, like, I think I just like got my street cred with Katie Nolan.
Yeah.
I, like, had
I was
this,
like, yo, that Peter Schrager's my inside.
He's inside. But like that kind of stuff. I'll text every, you know, guy I have at different teams, just be like, what are we thinking here, what are we thinking there? But what's fascinating this year is that Thursday night, we're doing a radio broadcast of it from Chicago.
Mm.
Me, or sorry, proper English, Jay Glazer, Joel Klatt, and myself.
Wow.
And we're doing it from a radio.
Heavy hitters.
Yeah, a radio studio in Chicago. Here's the thing with Glazer. He doesn't really, like, do the day-to-day, like, here's the latest transaction, but he has all the information. And on Thursday night, he does this crazy thing where last year we did this also. If you don't want to watch the ESPN or NFL Network broadcast, if you find the link to this, Jay is going to tell you who your team is taking like an hour in advance. It's like wild. So he's texting with whoever, and these are just names, but like Bruce Arians, Sean Payton, whoever, and they're like, we like this player. And It's amazing. So we're doing this broadcast, and it's not necessarily a play-by-play of the draft. It's us just discussing what's happening, but Jay is usually
ahead of the curve.
And that might spoil it for you. You might be like, I don't want to watch the draft that way.
Yeah.
But if it's you're tired of the same presentation of the draft and the whoop-de-doo, like this guy said, Jay has like a completely different way of analyzing it. And Joel was our lead college football analyst. And I feel like I can offer whatever I offer. And
Joel's great.
It's a different perspective. So radio Thursday night.
This is on Fox Sports Radio?
Fox Sports Radio. And they're going to be tweeting out a link to it so you can stream it.
Yeah. Talk to me about this, because I thought I saw an article that was it NFL Network and ESPN agreed to not tweet out the picks.
Yeah, because it is a TV show, right, Katie? Like, it is a show.
Yeah. So if... Not for us, it ain't. We don't give a fuck.
Yeah, the Patriots don't have a first-round pick.
No, I mean, just like Fox. Like, why would we give a shit?
Well, we are league partners, right? So I don't think we're going to do a TV show. I don't think we have the rights to that. But we're doing it like that. So what we're doing is we're going to spoil every pick. And Jay's whole thing is, I don't work for Twitter, so I'm not going to tweet him out. But he does work for Fox. And Jay, like last year, he had the top 10 picks after the second pick of the draft. And was just like, all right, and number 8, they're going to do this. Number 9, they're going to do this. He was right. It was eerie. It was crazy. So we're going to do that. We're going to try to offer something different. The NFL Network and ESPN has already stood behind this like noble thing that like we're not going to announce any news, yet they have Adam Schefter and whoever else NFL Network has out there as reporters. Schefter has all the same information. Like, he can come out, but out of respect to the league, they're not spoiling the greatest reality show that they have.
Would that frustrate you as like,
no,
if you were
it's
an
almost
employee?
Like, whew, all right, beautiful. Like, all right, I guess I don't have the pressure to do that.
Why even send Schefter? It's nothing to do.
If there's a trade, like, and we need to go back and see who did what for why, and it's interesting. So Jason Lockenfour is an interesting one to watch on this draft night, because he used to work for NFL Network and was under that same embargo. Now he's at CBS. And last year, just checking on Twitter, he was just like,
Oh yeah.
And he's like, you know, like, screw the world. Like, here's the pick. And people would complain at him like, dude, like, stop. Like, no one cares that you have it. Like, I want to watch it live and have it suspense. So I think the fans have spoken. They don't like having the pick spoiled.
On Twitter. But, like, I'd listen to a radio broadcast.
I mean, I can't.
The draft, I can watch, like, all rounds.
Oh, see,
and then
I love
like,
it.
Oh,
I watch all
God,
7 rounds.
So
I'm obsessed with it. I don't, even if I didn't work on this stuff, I think I would.
It's just when the clock is up and they're just clearly buying time and they're comparing that white receiver to the last white receiver. And it's like, I get it. Like, you're not, that's not even a valid comparison. You guys just have to fill airtime while it's like, clock noise. And then was it last year when it was like that I'm the Man song was the song they played every commercial break? And it's like, I just want to know who picks who.
Yeah, no, you're right.
And move on.
And there's two options, right? So it's on ESPN and NFL Network. So you could almost flick and it's the same thing they're pretty much doing. It's the same stuff. So, again, the Fox radio broadcast, I think Klatt's really good. And we're only doing the first night. So it's not like this deep dive and like the Texas Tech backup guard. Like, it's just the guys you care about.
John Johnson.
You got it.
John Johnson.
Katie brings out her big board.
Google it. I've got him on my big board. I sure do. You know what I always think is the most underappreciated, like, most probably difficult job in our industry is whoever has to scrub through all that footage.
Oh, it's amazing.
For all those players who could potentially get drafted, so that when someone's like, out of Texas Tech, John Johnson, and then they play a highlight reel of all his best hits, it's like, where'd they get all
No, it's crazy. I remember there was a player in the second round the Raiders took like 6-7 years ago named Mike Mitchell out of Ohio. He was a safety, and he wasn't on Mel Kiper's board. Kiper has 1,000 people, right? Mike Mitchell goes second round, which is not like eighth round, second round to the Raiders, and Al Davis liked him. He's actually still in the league, plays for the Steelers, and it was the biggest deal like in TV circles because ESPN didn't have footage of him.
Oh, my God.
And I think that's like the only guy ever like to go in the first couple of days, or they're just like,
sorry.
Don't know.
We'll talk about what he's like.
We'll talk about what he might be like if we were to know who he was.
But we don't know who that is.
And that was like classic Al Davis, just picking a guy that no one else had ever heard of. But also like cool to see that they're that good, they're that prepared with this footage, and they're that prepared as like analysts that you really rarely can stump them.
I love that though, when someone hashtag disrupts the broadcast.
I mean, that's Mike Mitchell's the rent the runway of the draft.
That's the kind of analysis you get here on the Garbage Time podcast. You think Twitter has changed the way we watch the draft to deal with the draft? I mean, I know you said that like people don't like them spoiled, but do you think like it's going to evolve?
On the lead up, it's a whole cottage industry within itself. So I'm like our draft expert, and I do love it.
He puts it in air quotes like
we don't have like a McShay or a Kiper who's full time doing it.
Yeah.
So like, when I'm not doing the season.
Full-time draft.
It's a crazy, but that's a real job. And that's why like when people like knock Mel Kiper, I'm like, he knows his stuff. Like, he's a full-time job to do this. Like, he definitely knows what he's talking about. But it's become a cottage industry in itself. Like, I'll get more, I hate talking about Twitter so much, like, as if it matters so much, but it's, I'll get more retweets. It does. I'll get more retweets and more write-ups about things I report just on, like, Derrick Henry might go second round and running back from Alabama.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then it's
the
like,
guy, he won the Heisman.
Yes. And then, like, Roto World.
I gotta explain that. There it is. Peter.
And then, like, Roto World will, like, do a recap off of that. And then Twitter will have a tweet, and then it's like 1,000 retweets, and it's wild. And, like, I'll have a mock draft up, and they'll tweet it out from the NFL on Fox account, and it's like 1,000 shares
it's
on
crazy.
This mock draft. When if I was to preview the Super Bowl and be like, I think the Broncos could beat the Panthers, you know, you get a couple hundred, like whatever. But like people want speculation and they always want to know about their teams. And it's become to the point where you can almost do metrics on like what things hit. So if you write about the quarterbacks, no matter what, people click. They love it. Cowboys, people love hearing about the Cowboys. Steelers, like anything you have, Cowboys, Steelers, it's fascinating, but it's a cottage industry in itself, and like it's real.
Yeah, I know that feeling. I tweeted out the other day that I was drunk and I tried to take my contacts out for 10 minutes before I realized I didn't have any contacts in. Like 3,000 likes. I'm like, what the fuck?
So what? So why do you think that
like
was? Why did that resonate?
Why
did that resonate?
Do you hate me? That's the only tweet I've ever sent out that I was like, why?
Why, right?
Why do you all like that? I think it's because I said I was drunk.
That's it.
I think people like the thought of me
in favor
pinching
of it?
At my cornea for 10 solid minutes.
Was that on vacation? Or
oh,
was that,
yeah. And the craziest part is I was so determined, and then I was like, okay, I felt it. It folded a little. I'm almost there. And then realized there weren't any contacts in, which means I folded my cornea.
Let me peel the onion a little bit.
I was just pinching at it, and the only moment I noticed is when I went to open the case to put it away and was like, oh, shit, there's a contact in there.
Uh-oh.
I should go to bed.
Uh-oh. Time to call it a night. Let me peel the onion. So that happens. That whole experience happens,
yeah.
Right? And I'm always fascinated by this. And you're great at Twitter. So
Thank you. What
makes you to think, I'm going to tweet about this?
Well, because my thoughts happen in 140 characters.
In like real time?
Sometimes I'll have a thought that I'm like, if I could figure that out, it'd be a great
tweet,
but I can't. I'm trying to think of what it was last night. I was watching the Golden State game.
Yep.
And Mark Jackson was talking about, he was like commentating the game.
Yeah, it's gotta be awkward.
And he was talking about how like Hack a Shack and all that should be, they should get rid of it. Or no, if they get rid of it, he took the Mark Cuban angle of like, you can't get rid of it because then that's awarding people for not being good at free throws.
Sure.
And you shouldn't award people for not having a skill. And I wanted to tweet, but couldn't fit it in small enough, something along the lines of like, oh, Mark Jackson, you mean like you weren't good enough to coach, but then they awarded you with the ability to commentate?
And you're like, I have this thought.
It's the perfect, but I
But
I
the
had
context
thought,
and like it's already
and
passed.
And I was like, once I try to put it in context, there won't be enough characters left for the tweet. And so those just go untweeted.
That's it. They're up here.
But that night, after trying to pinch my eyeballs out, my first thought was like, this is why drinking is dangerous.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I was like, hey, friends, next time someone tells you drinking is fun, think of me, the girl who just pinched your eyeballs out.
But
for
everyone's
10 minutes.
Been there, right? Like, who has context. So it's one of those
so
like Seinfeld
many.
Things. Like, it's a show about nothing, but we've all experienced that.
I got so many tweets that were like, oh, wait until you try to. Actually couldn't wear contacts for 2 years after I did that because I literally pinched out my eye.
I love it.
Crazy. And also gross and graphic. I think that was another reason why it landed. But, you know,
it
Twitter's
landed.
Just a crazy beast.
Have you ever had a tweet that we put out there feeling like it was good and then it's just like a fart in the wind? Like, just no one even, like, responds.
Yeah.
And you're like, I don't get it. I thought that was good. Like, I
can't
felt
remember specifically
that.
What it was, but I remember having that feeling of, like, what's up, people? This tweet's good.
Sometimes I'll have, like, even, like, NFL news, and I'm like, I think this is a monster, and I'm going to write it. And I put it out there, and it's, like, 8 retweets, and I'm like...
Yeah.
Right, I guess I misevaluated what the people care.
No one cares. Like, what the hell, Twitter? Sometimes it's just a strange beast. But then there's other times you hit send and you're like,
Just watch.
Just watch my
Drop
phone.
The
it's
mic,
about
right?
to fucking explode.
It's like a hot thing.
Like, I sent out a Tebow joke back when he was practicing with, like, the back when.
Eagles, right?
Yeah, it was last season.
Yeah,
it feels two years ago.
Last year.
And I sent out a tweet that was like,
and you're like
you
this,
can tell
like
Tim
dice.
Tebow's a virgin because of his unwillingness to. Try a new position. And it was like,
it was just perfect.
Explosion.
Yeah, like Hiroshima visual, just the mushroom cloud. That was it.
But
you
know those ones are coming. But yeah, sometimes I'll send them out and I'm like, hello,
yeah,
where
guys?
Are my fucking tweets?
And sometimes I wonder if it's the time of day that matters.
Yeah.
Or if
Someone
it's
should
who
look
retweets
into it.
You.
Yeah. I'll retweet you, Peter.
Someday.
Anyway, back to football.
Yeah.
While we were talking about how you're our draft guy.
Yeah.
This podcast is coming out Tuesday. You've got a 7-round mock draft that's going up today on FoxSports.com. How do you feel about it?
It's fun. This is like my favorite thing to do, and it sounds so geeky of me, but
it is super geeky.
Throughout the last 3 weeks, 4 weeks, I'll get a list of like thousands of players from different scouts of different teams I've become friendly with, and they're like, here's our list, you know, do whatever you want with it. And then I'll try to play mix and match, like, what does this team need? What does this team need? Now, the accuracy rate is very low because all it takes is one pick to set everything off. But the players are usually somewhat right, so I take a lot of pride in that. And fans love it. They love it.
I've been doing this
like 10 years now, like since like the nascent days of FoxSports.com. And fans eat it up. They love it. They're like, well, we wouldn't take that guy in the fifth round. Like, we don't need a wide receiver. And I'm okay with that. It's fun. So it's just names. And I always tell people, print it out. So on the third day, on Saturday, if you're watching, you can at least have something follow along and be like, where did this guy have it? Because it's impossible to get it right, but it's fun to see all the names.
Mock drafts and power rankings. People love that shit.
Love. And the weather. The weather, you don't know what's going to be right or
wrong. Yeah, that's people true. I mean, like, you're right. You could name all the people that are going to get taken in the first round, but you miss one and then it's going to disrupt your...
Yeah.
Hashtag disrupt your entire mock draft. So that must be... But it's good to know you don't feel stressed about it. It's not like, oh, no, I didn't get it right.
I was up late, though, last... Like, I've been up, like, late, like, doing it because you want to get it right. And then the third pick in the draft is bothering everyone. It's such, like, inside baseball, but... No one knows what San Diego's doing. Anyone who tells you they know what San Diego's doing is lying because they keep it all close to the vest. And I have them taking an offensive tackle, this guy, Laramie Tunsil. A lot of people have them taking Jalen Ramsey, a defensive back out of Florida State. And those two picks, if it goes one way, the draft goes a completely different direction.
Oh, wow.
Then if they take this guy, then it goes that way. So
whoa.
It could be
like
all blown up by the third
universes.
Pick. It really is. The bizarro world of the Chargers.
Oh, my God.
What would you do if you're the Chargers? Would you take a cornerback or would you take an offensive tackle?
I would take... the season off.
That's it. You'd say call it quits.
If I'm the Chargers, I'd be like, cool. We're in
San Diego. Last year was tough enough. Things are good.
Yeah. Phillip Rivers is probably getting his wife pregnant again.
I assume that's in the works.
She's like consistently pregnant.
Eight kids. That's a lot.
So.
All under the age of 13.
That is, to me, my personal hell. So I would take a break from impregnating my wife if I were the Chargers.
Have you ever met Rivers or come across Rivers?
I have not.
The best.
Seems like an interesting guy.
Amazing guy. And everyone's talking about, like, Peyton Manning's going to be great on TV. Phillip Rivers will be amazing.
Really?
He's funny.
Yeah.
He's like, yeah.
Is
he's
he
like super
weird?
Competitive, a little weird, but like Southern, but lives in San Diego. Like, just awesome.
Who's weirder, Andrew Luck or Phillip Rivers?
Luck's not weird.
He's fucking weird.
Luck's the kid in high school that was like, really good at sports, but wasn't necessarily the coolest guy. Do you remember that guy in high school? Like that guy has all the varsity letters, but he's also really like an honor student and wasn't invited to the party. No, Luck's not a dork, but like he's so into football and he's so smart and he comes from a family of football. Rivers is the man though. Like all his teammates love Rivers. Black guys, white guys, everyone loves hanging with Phillip Rivers. And then he gets out there and he's so intense that like you want to play for him.
Yeah.
Luck's cool though. I think I've met with Luck a few times. He's all right.
Why is Matthew Stafford aging backwards?
How so? You think he looks younger now?
He looks like a baby.
Really?
Every time I see him, he looks more like a baby. Benjamin Button.
Just got married last year. That could do it.
Every time I see him, I'm like, okay, and now he has a binky in his mouth. Why is this happening?
I've never even thought of this.
Like a babe child. I think his face is getting rounder, and so he's just looking more baby-like, or he is Benjamin Button.
He's going backwards.
Sums up. Sums
I like
up
that.
With that.
Who? I mean, I would ask this to a male as well, but who would be the one quarterback you'd want to hang out with socially? Not like,
Brady. But I mean, I guess
it's
a battle
possible.
For number two.
No, say it was Brady. Did Brady come across as someone you'd think we'd have a fun night with?
I mean, if we weren't wearing clothes, probably.
Stop that. No, like, if you were
just,
to, like,
if
go...
I'm allowed to sexualize him. I get sexualized every day.
If there's anything I'm allowed to do.
You mean if I have to hang out with a quarterback and, like, chat him up?
Yeah, and, like, hang out with socially, like, go out and have drinks and, like, everyone's hanging out in a group.
Jay Cutler.
I love it. I love it.
I don't think Kristen would like it, but she could come because then we could both talk about Stephen.
Dieter.
Yeah, just compare notes on Stephen. We've brought that full circle.
It was all planned.
All right, guys, more Schrager in a second, but first I'm going to tell you all about SeatGeek. I've been using SeatGeek for all my ticket needs when I'm looking to go to a game or a concert. I got hockey tickets on SeatGeek. baseball tickets on SeatGeek. It's super easy to use. I have the SeatGeek app on my phone. I've used it recently a bunch, like I just said. SeatGeek has taken all the work and hassle out of shopping for tickets. They pull all the tickets available on other sites into one place so you save time and never miss a deal. You can even set alerts for upcoming events, and SeatGeek will let you know if ticket prices fall, which is really convenient for forgetful people, like maybe someone in your life. Even better, every ticket on SeatGeek is ranked based on value, so you can immediately find underpriced seats, and before you buy, you can use SeatGeek's detailed maps to see the view from your seat. Best of all, SeatGeek is always honest and upfront about the price. Unlike StubHub, they show you the full ticket price from the start, and they never try to trick you with huge fees on the checkout page. And my listeners get a $20 rebate off their first SeatGeek purchase. So to get your $20 rebate on tickets, download the free SeatGeek app, go to the settings tab and click add a promo code, enter promo code Katie. SeatGeek will send you $20 after you've made your first ticket purchase. Download the free SeatGeek app and enter promo code Katie, that's K-A-T-I-E today. Okay, back to Schrager. All right, so actual draft stuff.
Yeah.
The Rams and the Eagles trading up.
Yep.
One and two, Goff and Wentz?
Yep,
is that what's
that's
happening?
That's the order, Jared Goff one. Carson Wentz, too.
You say confidently.
Confidently.
Well, Carson Wentz has done great things for Fall Out Boy, so I don't know that we write him off quickly.
Yeah, is there a relationship to Pete Wentz?
I don't know.
Nothing?
I don't
know. No Ashley Simpson tie to him?
Maybe.
Maybe.
Also tied to Ryan Cabrera, who I
love. You love, right? And what, like South by Southwest or something?
Yeah, I saw him there. I was going to go up to him. I didn't.
Really? Is he still with her? Or is it,
I don't think so.
No? That ended? That ended in the aughts?
I don't think they lasted through the aughts. They ought to break up forever ago.
So Goff, you're like the dichotomy of the two guys. So Goff is like the cool, good looking, like had it all, Northern California.
Had it all except a cool name. Goff is not, I don't want my quarterback to, I'm not buying a Goff jersey.
Goff, G-O-F-F.
That's not it for me.
So
it's like Duff. Like it's not a name you want.
He's
Goff.
From Marin County, which is like the ritzy like 1% area in like San Francisco. His father played baseball for a living. He was starting day one at Cal, like 3 years, and just like had this like great like trajectory to the pros. Wentz was like 5'10" coming out of high school, had a huge awkward growth spurt once he got to North Dakota State. No one else recruited him. Been dating the same girl since middle school. He's never gotten less than an A, like on any class.
Whoa.
Since he got to college.
I love him now.
And he's only played in 20 games.
Whoa.
So he's like.
So why is he so high?
Because he just had this crazy growth spurt and has all the physical build, and they had a great season this year. So he's kind of like out of nowhere. And Goff is this other kid where it's like, we've been grooming you to be a quarterback your whole life. So it's two totally separate, one from Northern California, San Francisco, the other one from Bismarck, North Dakota is where
it's
he's
like
from.
Team Edward and Team Jacob.
Yeah, you got to pick one.
I'm Team Carson. I'm Team Wentz.
I think I am too.
I love nerds.
Yeah, I don't necessarily know if he's a nerd, but he's certainly not like
a fucking nerd.
There was an article that I read, and they said that he, what he does for fun is he plays billiards. And I'm like, oh, that's cool. He's like in like the
who
bar.
Who calls it billiards?
I'm like, he's in the bar playing pool. Like, it's cool. They're like, no, not like drinking. He just like loves the game of billiards. And I'm like, sober pool. Like he plays sober pool. Like I've never seen that. I've never heard of that. He's just, you know, hitting the ball and that's
I've
good.
I've played sober pool.
You've done sober
pool?
That's
how you hustle.
That's how it
you
is.
You get a drink that looks like a drink.
Over the shoulder shot.
Yeah. Like, whoa, did that shot just getting, boop, eight ball.
Seven ball.
Yeah. Nailing it.
That's good. So those are those two. And I think they're interesting because last year, Mariota and Winston are both like Heisman Trophy winners and we were sick of like hearing all the things about them. These two, no one really knows. Mm. So it's like kind of cool. And both teams traded up to get them.
Yeah. But they're not like that flashy.
No, 6 months ago, if you told me that like those two were gonna be the first and second picks, I'd have been like, probably not.
Probs not, but yeah. Mabes.
But Mabes.
That's what I would have said.
And now
Probs
it's like,
prop and Mabes.
And now it's like obs.
Yeah, obs.
It's happening.
Totes.
Totes.
Why do you think the Eagles traded up?
I think.
What do you think of that?
Yeah, so they have a new coach in Doug Peterson, but the fascinating part is Chip Kelly was kind of running everything last year. He really wanted Marcus Mariota.
Mm.
And he offered like the next five drafts to get Marcus Mariota. The Titans were like, we're good. We're taking Mariota. So he doesn't get him. Now, Chip also had an issue, a clash of personalities with this guy, Howie Roseman, who's still there now. Howie was the GM. Chip came in and said, I'm going to be doing all the player decisions
now.
I'm the captain now. Exactly. That's it. Somalian pirate style.
Exactly.
That's it. Said, I'm the captain now. And not only pushed Howie to like the side, physically had him move his office to the other side of the building.
Petty.
So Howie now
Tom
is like
Petty.
Yeah. So Howie last year was like an exile, like sitting out there, has a job as like a VP of, you know, something, but wasn't dealing with the players on a day-to-day basis. Mm. Chip Kelly crashes and burns in Philadelphia. They fire him. They take Howie and they put him back in the GM role. So part of this is you couldn't get Mariota. You couldn't pull it off. You couldn't figure it out, Chip Kelly. But I can get this guy. I'm going to be able to trade it up. I'll be able to figure it out. And he does that move, gets the quarterback. And now they've got three quarterbacks in Sam Bradford, Chase Daniel, who's the highest paid backup quarterback in the league. And now this third guy who's going to be a rookie who's going to watch and learn. But I'll bring it all full circle to Fox. Donovan McNabb was their quarterback for years. But when they drafted McNabb second overall, McNabb sat for the first year behind Doug Peterson, who's now the head coach.
Oh, shit.
So there's this like perfect circle of, they have a philosophy where it's okay to not play right away.
It's better to not
let
play right away.
Let him just figure it out. Wentz was playing in Fargo, North Dakota 3 months ago.
Yeah,
let him figure out.
Fargo.
Yeah, because the Philly fans are not the easiest, and especially on
you
a rookie quarterback.
Say.
Yeah.
Didn't they pelt Santa?
That's
with
the rumor.
Snowballs.
I don't know if it's actually true.
Oh.
I do know that when Michael Irvin got knocked out with like a concussion, they were like throwing things from the stands.
I remember
on him.
That.
And that was ugly.
That was gross.
Yeah.
I like Michael Irvin.
So do
He's
I.
He's pretty dope. Who's going to be better in the NFL, Goff or Wentz? I'm Team Wentz.
Let's go Team Wentz. I'm
okay,
team Wentz.
Team Wentz. Can we make t-shirts? Team Goff, Team Wentz?
Team Wentz.
And again, no one's going to buy Team Goff because who wants to be Goff? Unless your first name is Jerkin.
Has that joke been made? That's great.
No.
Did you just think of that?
Yeah.
That's really good.
No, it's not. It would have been better if that was a real name.
Do you think he grew up with that?
What, like
Do you think
Jerkin
anyone thought
Goff?
Of that and was like, hey, Jerkin?
I don't know.
It's fascinating.
Is that fascinating?
Yeah.
That's why I like you.
That's really good.
You think my jokes are a lot funnier than
they
are.
That's really good. Well, you got away with words.
If you had to compare them to, because that's what you fucking draft people do.
Yeah.
Who's Goff that's in the NFL right now and who's Wentz?
Yeah.
To make this easier for me to digest.
Goff is Alex Smith to me. And that's not an insult. I think Alex Smith's a pretty good NFL quarterback.
He's consistent.
He's going to win you 10 games. And he's, you know, he's not a big guy, Goff. He's 210 pounds. Doesn't have a huge arm, but he's really smart and really good with his feet. Mm. And Wentz could be anywhere from Roethlisberger, like this big, hulking, just whip it out, you know, throw it far, or Bortles, who I think is also pretty good, but same kind of physical build. So those would be my two analogies.
Cool, I like them. You mentioned earlier, and this is interesting to me because I'm not as tuned in as you are, obviously, but Derrick Henry, who won the Heisman, is slipping now.
Yeah, I don't know if he's slipping. I don't know if he's supposed to be a second or third round pick, and you'd think a Heisman Trophy winning running back who, you know, just had this amazing season. Why would you? It's a couple things. One, it's the position of running back isn't valued as much in the draft anymore. And two, the history of these Alabama running backs hasn't been very good, and that stuff matters. So Eddie Lacy's been up and down. Trent Richardson.
On the scale, for
On the scale,
sure.
Exactly, though. But, like, you know, Trent Richardson.
Just got another job?
Just got another job with the Ravens. Apparently he's slimmed down. But the history of these Alabama running backs, you can go right down the list. There's not a great measure of success. And even Mark Ingram, who was a first-round pick, hasn't been, like, worth a first-round pick. So teams are looking at it and saying, well, Alabama has five future pros playing on the offensive line. They've got Amari Cooper at wide receiver. They've got an all-pro at the other wide receiver spot. Is it plug in anyone and they're going to have those kind of numbers?
Yeah.
Or is it this guy? Now, the wild thing is there's another guy named Kenyon Drake, who's a running back for Alabama, who's in this draft, who was, like, their third running back. Some people think he might get drafted before Derrick Henry because he's got less tread on his tires and he's like super fast.
That's insane.
Yeah.
That's crazy how that works.
Yeah, it's
like,
wild.
Oh, cool Heisman. Go fuck yourself.
Yeah, exactly. Enjoy the Heisman.
That's nuts. What about Ezekiel Elliott?
He's awesome.
Yeah.
I had
cool
someone,
because we had him on the show.
Did
for
you?
The,
yeah, he had the fake. You
yeah,
guys
with
had
the abs.
The abs.
Mm, those weren't fake. That's they're all ripped.
That's it. These guys.
All of our producers are just ripped.
So I was told that the Cowboys are going to take him number four, which is like crazy early.
Do they need?
They were ninth in the league in rushing, but they fell in love with him apparently. So the Cowboys are another weird team. If the Chargers take Jalen Ramsey at three, I think the Cowboys would take Ezekiel Elliott, a running back, at four.
That's insane.
A bunch of people have said that they think he's the best running back to enter the draft since Adrian Peterson. That comes from like three or four people saying that. So that's really high praise. If you fall in love with the guy, you fall in love with the guy. If they don't get him and they take Joey Bosa or Jalen Ramsey or whoever, look for the Miami Dolphins, who have the 13th pick, to trade up and get Ezekiel Elliott, because I'm heard they are in love with him also. Yeah. So
I want, I'd rather, so this is tough for me because I'd rather him go to Miami.
Why is that?
Because I don't like
the Cowboys.
I don't like the Cowboys.
But as a Patriots fan, do you want to have to deal with Ezekiel Elliott?
No, that's what I'm saying. Like, that's why I should be like, oh, take him, Cowboys.
But no matter what, the Cowboys are getting a great player at four.
I don't want them to. He seemed like such a nice guy with a good head on his shoulders.
So he can change
that
whatever your impression of them.
That system doesn't seem to like encourage you to be a good guy with a good head on your shoulders.
It's tough with the Dallas Cowboys because if he went to like Green Bay or he went to Cincinnati, you kind of fade away. Like you don't have to worry about things. You kind of do your own thing. But in Dallas, more than any other market, they are such rock stars. Mm. Like if he gets drafted fourth overall, he will have 30 endorsement deals and he'll have his face everywhere. It's how do you handle that? And I think
he'll handle it okay. He seemed like he had a really good head on his shoulders.
He did. He's a great kid.
But you could go one of two ways, and I don't want him to be I got to stop caring about football players as people, I think.
I think that's right.
I have to just treat them like pieces of meat.
That's it.
On the market.
That's it.
Let's get back to naked Tom Brady in that case.
That's it.
No, I'm just kidding. Who's the guy in this year's draft that we're going to look back at the draft and be like, can you believe he went in the fifth round?
Oh, yeah. That's funny. That's so hard to predict.
I know, but predict it.
Yeah.
Right now.
Yeah. I like this guy, Josh Doctson.
Receiver, like the dog?
Yeah. Doctson, sort of. Receiver out of TCU. He might go first round, you know, but everyone is really like talking him up now in the last couple of days, which usually is a good sign that there's a lot of heat with this guy. So he's a receiver, TCU. He might be the first receiver taken in the draft, or he might slip to the second round. But I think he could be as good as like an A.J. Green, Julio Jones type of guy.
Okay.
If that's the case, if he doesn't go top five, there it is. But
he'll be the dude.
You know, if you're asking me who's like this year's Victor Cruz or John Brown, there's so many guys. I like a guy, Ricardo Lewis.
Ooh,
out of
Ricardo.
Auburn. Ricardo Lewis, Auburn, wide receiver.
Okay.
I think he'll be good next year, and he won't get drafted until the third day.
Okay.
It's not sexy to talk about.
No, Ricardo that's super. I am on fire right now. Whoo! Let's move on to like the stuff happening other than the draft.
Yeah.
In the NFL, we talked about Tom Brady. Can we not?
Yeah, we don't have to.
Cool. Skip it.
It's a lot of legal stuff. That's the thing that like makes it difficult. At this point, they're bringing on the legal experts on ESPN. And no offense to the Andrew Brants and the Roger Cossacks and whoever else, but like they're not entertaining. They're not. It's like that stuff is not what we're watching sports for.
Yeah.
So it's tough to like dive into
that. And figuring out the actual legality and
making
sure you don't misspeak.
One of my favorite writers is a guy, Dan Wetzel. He's great. We sit next to each other in press boxes all the time.
Wetzel the pretzel.
Wetzel the pretzel. He writes for Yahoo. And
we've never met.
He is like the expert on this Deflategate stuff. And he told me everything like, and he knows it. And even I think like reading like what Dan's got to say is like my first stop. And I have to like take a break in the middle of it. Cause
it's like too much.
I didn't go to law school. Yeah. I don't know it. Yeah.
You didn't? I could have sworn.
No, I didn't go to law school.
You sound like, I like the way you say law school. Law school.
My Jersey accent.
I didn't go to law school.
I didn't go to law school.
What do you want from me?
Lay
I didn't
off.
Go to law school. Lay off. Get some coffee.
Yeah.
Josh Norman.
Yeah.
Weird. Seemingly sort out of nowhere. See, I sort was of. On vacation. So for me, I missed most of this.
Sort of weird.
But like Washington?
Oh, no, that's not the weird part. That's Daniel Snyder being like, I don't know if it's out there. Daniel Snyder sent the team jet to get him.
Wow.
And they flew him in on a private jet, had a fleet of black cars. They said, bring your family. We're not letting you leave. You're signing. We're going to pay you the top money. We promise you that. So, like, that wasn't the weird part. The weird part was that the Panthers just said, you know what? Screw it. Let him go. And, you know, I think you would appreciate this as a Patriots fan. Belichick, over the years, has said goodbye to Lawyer Malloy and Richard Seymour and Logan Mankins and Randy Moss and Deion Branch. And it's kind of like when they think you're worth this much, but you want that much, they'll let you go. And they'll just go on. Chandler Jones got traded this year because who knows why, but they wasn't worth it for the Patriots. Mm-hmm. The Panthers are the only other team that I think is really much like that, where they were the ones who cut Steve Smith. They said, Steve Smith, you're the greatest player in our franchise history, but we need to sign Cam Newton and Luke Kuechly, so we're going to let you go. D'Angelo Williams, you know, you're an amazing Panther. We have to let you go, and this is the case with Josh Norman. So they save their money for certain things, and cornerback is not one of them. So it was wild that it all went down that way. But for them, they save money, and now they can re-sign a guy like Kawan Short, who is not as flashy a name
right.
as Josh Norman, but a guy they want more.
But Norman has come out, right, and said that he really wanted to stay with the Panthers. They just weren't. How much does that suck for Washington? That's like, we were comparing it earlier to you. You break up with your ex, and then you're like, wait, do you want to get back together? And like, no, I'm kind of over you. And you're like, ah, shit, you won't have sex with me? Will you have sex with me? Okay, fine, only because they won't.
Fine, yeah, and you'll buy me flowers? Yeah, that's awesome, cool, that's cool. That's kind of what it is. Like, they offered him, you want to talk numbers, but they offered him $11 million a year for 4 years, and he wanted $16 million. And he ended up getting $15 million from the Redskins. So at the end of the day, he can smile and laugh like, all right. And I think it's cool that he goes to the NFC East because now he plays Odell Beckham twice a season every year.
I wanted these two players to sign him so bad just so we could watch that happen.
These two players do not have much respect for each other on the field. I don't know about off the field.
But so Washington has a history of blowing it with free agents. So you think that this is going to be remembered as like another miss?
He's 29. He's not like one of these 23-year-olds where it's like we've got... So they signed him. They wanted him badly, and they got him. And to me, I don't think it's a miss. I think he's pretty good, so we'll see.
You know, producer Matt is a huge Washington team fan.
Yeah.
Should he be excited or scared?
I'd be concerned about Cousins, personally, because he didn't sign a long-term deal, and they're far apart still. So I don't think that's getting handled in the next couple months. And if you play a whole season on, like, a lame duck situation, it just looms. So that's an interesting one when you have your quarterback who doesn't have a contract for next year.
That's seemingly not a smart move. Well, speaking of Washington quarterbacks, RG3 in Cleveland. How do you think that's going to
go? I'm not an RG3 guy.
No?
No.
Why not?
I think once his knee got messed up, he wasn't the same guy.
Which is unfortunate because it wasn't his fault. He got pushed. He left him out there. He wasn't ready.
I just don't see it. I don't think he's the most we'll see. Hugh Jackson apparently likes him, but to me, Robert Griffin didn't show me anything this year. He was fully healthy. Preseason was given every opportunity to win the job, didn't, and then really didn't show much the last 3 years. So for them to give him $6.5 million based on the hope that he gets back to what he was 4 years ago before tearing up his knee, that's a lot. And they have the eighth pick right now. They could go with Paxton Lynch, a quarterback, eighth overall. Everyone thinks Lynch is like an end of the first round guy.
Paxton Lynch.
Is that not a great name? Is that not a name for Laguna Beach?
They talk about having two first names. That's two last names.
So he's a 6'7" quarterback out of Memphis is where he went. Had this like out of nowhere year this year. It was great. Everyone's talking about Goff and Wentz, but this Paxton Lynch might go top 10 also. I think the Browns could take him, and then if that's the case, it's him, Griffin, and then you go from there.
Well, yeah, I mean, I saw the movie Draft Day, so I know that they take Paxton
works.
Lynch.
Yeah, they would right do that, away. Right? They write a note down. I liked Draft Day.
You would.
I saw it on a flight. I loved it.
Garbage.
I loved it.
But you're on the inside, so
I
think
you would
watch it.
If that's the case,
you'd
think I would be disgusted and be like, oh, come on.
That's not how it works. Is that how it works?
I think I like all sports movies.
I think you like Kevin Costner. Which means you like all sports movies.
Yeah, just like all of his movies, yeah. But I saw another one, The Million Dollar Arm with the two Indian kids who play in John Hamm. Great movie.
Why are you?
No one has seen these movies.
ESPN movies.
Is it an ESPN movie?
The Million Dollar Arm one is. I don't know about Draft Day.
I loved them
both. Draft Day was so bad.
It was great.
Is that really what it's like?
No.
Yeah, see? So why would you want?
I don't understand why they had a female character. They've really just had her in there for no reason. This love interest.
Yeah, fucking women. What are they doing in that movie? Almost this is a sports movie.
They're almost patronizing her by having... What's her name? Jennifer Garner?
Yep.
Terrible.
No, she was a power player
film. That was strange. I don't think you need the love interest in every film.
I took a nap in the middle of that movie.
I love Draft Day.
Oh, God. Get out of here.
I thought it was good.
Where's Colin Kaepernick going to go?
I think he's going to stay in San Francisco.
Really?
If he goes anywhere, he's going to be traded on Thursday.
Oh, shit.
And it's going to happen like this week.
Okay.
That was an interesting one because the reports from other places was the parameters of the trade is done. They're just waiting to figure out what they're going to pay Kaepernick and what draft picks they're giving up. Mm. Well, if that's the case, those are the parameters of the trade, right? Like, how much money is he going to make? So right now, he's set to make $12 million, and the Broncos are willing to do the trade if they don't have to give up any draft picks, and they can pay him $7 million. So no, that's not how this works. You don't just dictate. So
that's not how any of this works.
No, it doesn't. So I think the Broncos are the only team I can think of where he'll end up. And if it doesn't happen on the draft weekend, I think he's in San Francisco. And I think...
Playing?
I think Blaine Gabbert might be the guy.
Mm. Yeah. Yo Gabba Gabbert, as he's
like
known
Gabbert.
Here. Yeah, Yo Gabba Gabbert. Speaking of quarterbacks that we like on this show/podcast, Osweiler. Why did they let him
Wait,
go?
Why do you like him?
Because he's Brock Lobster.
That's just your thing.
Well, so I liked him. Here's the thing. I liked him because I sang songs about him. And that, you know, whenever I sing a song about someone.
B-52s.
Yeah,
like,
yeah. Whenever I sing a song about someone, I feel a sense of solidarity.
Yeah.
But I almost met him. I think I told you this. At the Super Bowl.
No, what
Media
happened?
At Media Day. And he was walking around because, you know, they have some of the ones who are behind the things. And I felt bad for Brock because he got them to the Super Bowl. Oh. And then he's just walking around, even with his own podium.
Carries the team to week 17 and gets benched. And now he's just another guy.
Just another guy walking around. And so I was going to go up to him and ask him questions about being Brock Lobster. And I overheard someone ask him a question about something silly. And he was like, I'm only answering football questions. And it was like, okay, Brock, well then, football question, why'd you get benched?
Yeah.
Like, if you want me to ask you football questions, you're not going to like them at all because they're not going to be about you playing because you're not.
Yeah.
So as soon as I saw him not willing to embrace the, like, here's cult what,
I would
hero,
take it differently on this one if I were you. You're Katie Nolan.
Okay.
Whoever approached him with that goofy, zany question was probably tacky. Probably lame. Mm-hmm. It was probably a question about, like, wow, you're 6'7". What's it like being so tall? Like, you would have been clever.
What's the weather like?
What's
up
the
there?
Weather like up there? So you would have been clever. You would have said, we have a thing on our show, which is on a national network. You might have heard of it. Like, I totally would always go for it if I were you.
Okay.
Don't ever think about, you know, Susie or Joe from Des Moines and their, you know, zany telecast. Mm-hmm. You're Katie Nolan.
Oh,
own
shit.
That.
Wow.
We could have had Osweiler Gold.
Good.
But I do like Brock Osweiler.
Yeah.
He's making $18 million a year now, so he's been given all this responsibility. The weird thing was he had never met Bill O'Brien until he signed his contract, which is, like, crazy. But O'Brien just felt confident from what he saw that this is the guy. And they also added a running back, Lamar Miller. So they're going to be more fun this year,
fuck,
I think.
Lamar Miller.
What do you make of...
I drafted him 1 year for fantasy, and I paid way too... It was an auction draft. I paid way too much money, and he just was a dud, and I'll never get over it.
I'd be curious for your answer on this one, and I'm going to take the fifth because I really don't know the answer, but
I'll certainly know
As someone who in you're a sports media, you, like, take it all in, and you kind of, like, offer an interesting perspective. What do you make of J.J. Watt? Do you have takes? Because there's a lot going on there.
Well, I mean, is that something recently happened that
I don't know? No, just Peter King did another article he did another article. He went up to his Wisconsin ranch and it's like, he's working out and people just, it's
we
a lot.
We get it. I'm
we
tired
it, right?
of J.J. Watt telling me how much he works out. And then, you know, we'll watch the Hard Knocks, and it's getting dark out, and he's still working out, and then he stays, and he signs autographs, and, like, all of that's really cool, but, like, act as if, and stop telling me about it.
Okay.
That's the thing that bugs me. I don't think he's a bad guy. People are like, oh, you slam Greg Hardy for being a piece of shit, but you also slam J.J. Watt for being a nice guy, and it's like, those two things are not the same.
No, they're not.
I'm just sick of J.J. Watt telling me how great he is.
Interesting, okay.
I think maybe he's got, like, a skeleton or two in his closet that
really?
He's distracting us with by walking grandmothers across the street all the time.
Yeah.
Or, like, wishing your grandmother a happy birthday on Instagram. Does your grandmother have an Insta?
That's a great point.
Is she an Instagram mother? Like, she's not going to see that. So you can just take a break and go work out in your log cabin, which
That's
is
it.
A mansion.
Apparently,
like,
it's sick.
Huge.
Yeah, it's
sick. Not a log cabin. You didn't build it
like
Johnny
Appleseed.
He
flew up the whole team up there. Now, I've dealt with Watt a few times, and that's why I, like, took the fifth, because he's nothing but awesome, like, to deal with.
I bet he's great.
But I see that, you know, the internet turns, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I saw... The Barstool guys were taking shots. Some other people were taking shots. Mm. And it's like, I wonder if he's aware of it, that it's changing. Like, the people are...
I think I've seen him send out tweets along the lines of, like, I know you guys are sick of hearing about this, but... So I think he gets it, but he's not stopping, which is like, JJ, just stop.
One more question on social media for you.
This is what the interview's about.
This is how it goes. Mm. What do you make about the public grieving for celebrities on Twitter and all that?
It's a tough... thing to navigate, because
it's like, stop being cynical. It's okay if someone wants to say something.
I think so, but okay. I don't think it needs to go on for hours and hours and hours. And I also think there's a lot of people. The weird thing, like when Prince passed, I saw a lot of tweets that were like, "Never really a fan, but R.I.P." That tweet is useless. Get that fucking tweet right out of my timeline. I didn't really like this guy, but he died, so R.I.P. Like, that's dumb.
Yeah.
It didn't mean or matter. Like, it meant nothing to you, and you just had to fire off a tweet into the ether.
You know,
just leave that one in your brain.
Yeah.
Make that, like, my Mark Jackson tweet. Don't send just that one out. Like,
what's
just
the point?
Leave it.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, it's fucking Prince, man.
Okay, but it was also David Bowie. It was also Fife Dog. It was also Glenn Frey. It was also... And it's the same people... tweeting that their days are shattered each time. I'm wondering if it's becoming a cottage industry to be the
most sad.
The most sad, or my life is the most devastated, or I'm more impacted.
Well, this all sort of started happening because we're the generation that, like, social media started to be a thing.
I put Glenn Frey in that conversation.
I know, I like that. We're the generation where social media started being a thing. So I remember in high school, or no, not high school, because I was in college. Maybe I'm thinking of AIM. But anyway, like a friend's father passed away, or like a person you barely knew, family member passed away, and they would make it their away message, and you were just like what are you doing? You're searching for people to... It was always a weird...
It's a weird thing,
right? Do you put
it
out there, or do you not? But I think we're in an age where social media is becoming so prevalent that, like, this is what we do now.
And I guess everyone just can grieve in their own way, right?
Yeah.
So it's not a bad thing if you didn't tweet...
But you do feel the stress of like, oh my God,
I have to tweet about Prince?
Do I have to tweet,
about this?
Well, I tweeted about my best memory of Prince.
Okay, what was that?
In a bathroom in Jersey City, I danced to The Most Beautiful Girl in the World. That song means a lot to
me. Can be. Yeah, it's a great tune. So you did tweet that. And what was your feeling there? Just like, hey, I have something
to
share?
Just like, this is how great Prince was. That song, I was like getting ready at like 6 a.m., and that song was played in a very romantic way and like slow danced too, because Prince can make your life that much better because his music was so good. Or you'll be like in a bodega and you'll hear any of his songs and you're like, yeah. It's gonna be a good day.
Yeah.
Like, it's hard to grieve Prince because when you listen to Prince, you're like, wait, I feel happy.
Yeah.
I'm supposed to be sad because he died, but I'm feeling like I want a party right now. Like it's 1999.
Can I tell you an interesting one? So I was talking to a guy who said, it sucks now when these celebrities die because you find it out from like a million tweets and it's just like all at once and you're like, oh, like what? You don't even get the chance to. Here's how I found it out, which was crazy. I'm on the subway.
Yeah.
I get on the subway in New York and some
just
random.
Just like celebrities, just like us.
Just like us.
Peter Schrager riding the subway.
Some random guy comes up to me and is like, hey, did you hear the news? And I thought he was like a crazy person. And I'm like, no, what? He's like, Prince just passed away. And I'm like,
people love that.
And I'm like, wow. And he's like, I just wanted you to know. And I was like, I just wanted everyone to know. And I'm like, but
okay,
I thought that was kind of a cool New York moment.
No, like, that's like that to me is even weirder than tweeting it. Like, the guy who finds out then goes to an area where they know no one has service and is like, hey, everyone, Prince dead.
See, I thought I liked it better.
I'm the Adam Schefter of this train. Breaking sources, Prince dead.
See, but I like that better than like finding it out from 1,000 tweets of like, no, like, definitely true. Like, that's what it was.
Did he hug you?
No, he was just like a normal guy, and it wasn't a crowded subway. He was like, and like, I think he was looking for someone to like kind of share the moment with, because he was pretty shook up.
Yeah.
And I was like, huh, that's a pretty cool New York moment.
Well, there was that like 5 minutes before we found out he died where it was either R.I.P. Prince or
TMZ sucks.
No, holy fuck, Prince killed a guy. Because it was like body found
at
Prince's studio.
Okay,
has not been identified. And so I almost like right as we found out he died, I was about to tweet, and I guess thank God I didn't. Either R.I.P. Prince, or no, I said BuzzFeed is working on two articles right now.
Yeah,
they have one guy working
versions
on like the 15 best Prince songs, and the other ones that are like 13 Prince songs that proved he was a murderer before we knew. Like,
that's it.
Nobody knew who the body was.
I'm gonna finish with one Prince thing that I can't even, like, this is the best thing, and I haven't gotten it yet, but do you know who Spoon is? Spandan Daftari from Fox? He's a producer.
He produces
the NFL kickoff show on Fox. And he produces Randy Moss. So Randy Moss lived in Minnesota for a decade, right? So Spoon was talking to him this past week, when I guess after the news came out. And Randy's first comment was, Spoon, in my 40 years on this earth, I never thought there'd be a day I saw Superman fight Batman, but that was today. So like Randy Moss saw that movie and was like freaked out by it. I love that story. But second of all, he told Spoon, and I haven't gotten it yet, he has an amazing Prince story of Prince and Randy Moss. So we have to find a way to get that.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
The world needs that.
Right?
Now.
So I don't know what it was, and he was like, it was just
when
over text.
When did we find out?
I got to ask him. I got to figure it out.
No, they're going to win the Emmy, because that's going to come out.
No. I think Randy's very private with those kind of things, and I probably didn't love me saying that out loud, but I've got to find that story.
to plug you real fast, as yeah. you said before, don't forget, Schrager is hosting the Fox Radio broadcast of The Draft with Jay Glazer and Joel Klatt. Klatt.
Thursday night, it starts at 7:30 Eastern, 4:30 Pacific, and we'll be tweeting out links to it, but it's on the Fox Sports Radio.
And it really sounds great.
I honestly think it's going to be cool. Like, Jay is, like, plugged in, and Klatt's cool, and it's not as structured as maybe
Klatt
what you're used to.
Like, the easiest guy to work with.
Yeah, he's a great dude.
He's so, you can always depend on him to, like, carry you if you fuck up.
Absolutely.
Which you don't, but I do.
No, but Joel, I honestly say this to him, I think if he wanted to, he could do play-by-play also.
He could do anything he wants.
So he's really talented.
He could model.
He's all right looking.
He's cute.
Is he, like,
all
model
right looking?
Looking? Joel's all right.
Oh, shit, is this, you're throwing
yeah, slow down with the modeling.
Shade at Joel Klatt. He's very handsome.
I think he's gorgeous. He's one of my best friends, but, I mean, when you say model, you're really making a big leap there, Katie.
Ah, Schrager, are you jealous? Schrager, you could model, too.
Thank you. Yeah, so Joel could be a model.
Jay Crew is looking for sweater models
model.
All the
sweater
time.
Models.
Since I can't ask you the garbage 10 because you've done it already,
yeah.
I just have garbage one. I have one question. Did you see Lemonade, and what do you think?
No, I have no idea what it was. Saw everyone tweeting about it, put my phone down, watched like an NBA playoff game instead. But, so quickly, it's an album, but it's on HBO.
No. God, I have to explain everything
to you. I clicked
on
it. She was underwater. She was like, there was all weird stuff going on. I clicked on it.
I clicked on it. You sound like my dad.
I clicked on
that Lemonade.
But like Jay-Z and who's Rachel Roy? I don't know what's going on.
So Lemonade is an album. It was originally released exclusively on Tidal, which is Jay-Z's
streaming. So it's already been out
service.
For a little bit?
Now it's on iTunes.
Okay.
But the thing on HBO was an hour-long special that tied together little snippets of all the songs, but it was a visual representation of the album. So it was like this crazy video with poetry and
Serena Williams was in it,
Serena Williams was twerking and Kevenzine Wallace was in it and it was just a lot of, it was beautiful,
it
very
looked
well
beautifully
done.
Like the DP on that thing deserves all the awards.
But the like first 40 minutes is, and it was an hour, first 40 minutes is basically all about how Jay-Z cheated on her. She as like almost says that exactly. Says things like, you're a big famous rapper. What are you going to cheat on me? Why
but
would
like,
you cheat on me?
Did he not have any involvement in this album?
Well, so he did. So he's at the end of the video. It ends up, it ends
they
in forgiveness.
They reconcile.
And everything is, but so this dates back to the elevator thing.
Yeah, Solange.
With his, yeah, and she
boom,
was
boom,
mad.
Room.
Because
I remember it all.
Exactly. Because apparently Jay-Z slept with Rachel Roy, who is a woman who was working on, what's Jay-Z's clothing? Rockaware. And then went and did
she mention her name in a song? She's like,
no, she called her Becky with the good hair. And then Rachel Roy sent out a Instagram that was like, good hair, don't care, right after Lemonade came out. So everyone was
she
like,
knew it was
oh my
her.
God, you're Becky with the good hair.
Good career boost for her.
I don't know what.
Where'd she come from? Rachel
bad,
Roy, trending on Twitter. Rachel
bad
Roy, good
career
for
move for Rachel Ray, who everybody is mistaking for Rachel Roy and just
funny.
Shitting on her Instagram.
That's funny.
They're like posting like Instagram, like emojis of lemons.
And I've been told that the Beyonce fans are a very...
The beehive.
Like, the beehive online. Like, you do not mess with the Beyonce
fans,
right?
No, you don't.
Right?
Same thing with, like, Nicki fans. I don't remember. What do they call them?
The Menajos.
That is not correct, but close. So, yeah, it's a whole big thing. I can't believe you haven't seen it. You have to see it.
I'll watch it.
You have to see it before you watch the first episode of our show.
Okay.
I'll tell you that much. Peter, thank
okay.
you for being here.
Sneak peek.
This was really fun.
I love talking to you.
Go get on a plane to Chicago.
I'm going.
Okay, pound it.
Yo.
Later, bro. All right, thanks again to Schrager for being here. Very cool of him to come by in the middle of a busy week. I learned a lot. Hopefully you learned a lot too. Be sure to subscribe to this podcast on iTunes and rate it and leave a comment. But as usual, only if it's 5 stars and only if the comment's nice. Because what good is being negative? Really, what has it ever gotten you? Nothing. Or you can listen on Art19 SoundCloud, Stitcher, or Google Play. Thank you all for listening. Bye. Love you. Mean it.